It wasn't until I got to the church and I was walking down the aisle and I was standing at the altar, I was like shaking. I was like, oh my God.
Well, some people get married and they sort of just sort of age, don't they? They become sort of old. And that's because they haven't had kids. So for me, it's still sailed and sealed.
It took me 5 months to find my wedding dress and didn't have a clue what I wanted.
It was as if he couldn't believe his luck because he'd met this lovely girl and he was saying to him, God, I'm still pinching myself. I can't believe I've met this girl. She's so pretty and young and I think, you know, she's right for me.
My brother jumped behind and started dancing with her. And at the time, I was really, really jealous, you know. I was thinking, you know, I've just told him that, you know, I like this girl. And he's gone to dance behind her.
Everybody happy, everybody fantastic.
Silvia and I met at her cousin's wedding, Pina and Nick's wedding. We were sitting in the reception and we were sitting near the back of the hall and she was near the front on the right hand side. And me and my brother, like we normally do at the weddings, we always talk about, you know, the women at the wedding. We were both single at the time and there was a couple of young ladies there and Silvia caught my eye. I said to my brother, oh yeah, she's really nice. And behind my back, when the train song came on, my brother jumped behind and started dancing with her.
He had his eyes on Silvia. I didn't know that, obviously. You know, I'm just getting on. I'll chat to everybody anyway. So as I said, you know, there was a particular song came on and the DJ was saying, oh, you know, get behind, long dance, start doing, put your hands on your knees. And literally, it was like a caterpillar type scenario. And he just basically, he was behind me. I didn't know that he sort of fancied her and from that point of view. So I'm going forward, you know, having a little laugh, and have a joke, and after at the end of it, he's like, I think I like her, I'm gonna ask her for a number.
Just as Silvia came close to me, I just looked at her and I had the courage to say, you know, next song, would you like to dance with me?
We started dancing though, we did start to dance to Ricky Martin.
And then the music changed, and it changed to a slow song, Italian slow song, Eros Ramazzotti, Allora. And normally they use that as the first dance. It's a very Italian,
it's
romantic.
Really, it's a love song.
And so the bride and groom come up to dance, but I was so looking at Silvia that I didn't realise what was going on. So we started dancing and we were the only ones on the dance floor. And as the bride and groom were introduced to come on the first dance, me and Silvia were already dancing.
And we were talking to each other as well, so we didn't really notice what was going on around us.
So we really gate crashed their first dance. Love at first sight, it was more connection and looking at each other and thinking, yeah, she's...
Well, there was a sparkle.
There was a little sparkle.
Bright sparkle there. We worked hard at it.
Yeah.
We had ups and downs.
I mean, after the wedding, I text her, she gave me her number and I text her and said, look, I'm home, you know, waiting for my parents to get home.
Because I was still at the wedding,
she
left
wedding.
Earlier.
And she's still got that text to this day on her phone.
Oh my God.
And a few days later, I texted her and phoned her.
She went
on holiday for a few weeks.
And we were texting each other whilst we were on holiday, and then I'd run out of credit on my phone. And luckily, he worked at Orange at the time, so he put credit on my phone for me. So he could carry on talking while I was on holiday. Then I came back from holiday and we met up. And then it just sort of, because we only used to see each other one day a week, because he used to live so far away, and I'm working in the week, he was working in the week. I didn't have a car at the time, and so he'd have to drive an hour distance, plus when there was traffic, sometimes it would take 2-3 hours. One day a week, we used to see each other for about a year and a half, was it?
The families knew each other. Sal really didn't know Sil, so to speak, because they're from this end, from the Surrey part of London, whereas we're down in Hoddesdon. But as from there, then they started meeting each other and he started doing his 45-minute journey backwards and forwards every weekend. But that's really it, and then the rest is history.
At the wedding, I thought, you know, she might be too young for me, you know. But I got away with it. Got away with it. I always wanted to propose at Pisa, on top of the Tower of Pisa. But before that, I was speaking to my brother and his best friend. I said, look, I'm thinking of proposing. Where's the best place to buy a ring? He goes, well, I'm in London next week. Come and meet up with me. So we met up in Hatton Gardens. We went to a few little jewellers there. And my brother just remembered that as we were leaving, like 5 o'clock in the evening, we go, oh, I know this person who does rings, you know, and then sells them to the shops downstairs. So it saved me a lot of money. And I got a nice big ring, as you can see from here. Spent quite a bit of money on her. She didn't have no idea. I mean, we got in the car, picked her up, we got in the car.
And we left at like 6:30 in the morning, we're in the car. And I was like, oh, tell me when we're nearly there and so I can start putting some makeup on, because I was like 6:30 in the morning, I wouldn't put makeup on that early. So we got halfway, every junction on the M25 that led to somewhere, I was like, oh, are we going here? Are we going to Heathrow? And I was like, no. Are we going to Stansted? We go, no. Are we going to...
So we did like the M40,
everywhere,
and then the A1,
going,
the M1,
like, no,
and then
no.
We got onto the M11, and she still didn't have an idea.
I was like,
you know,
where are we going? And I was thinking, naming all these places that these roads lead to, and I didn't have a clue. It wasn't until we turned up at Stansted Airport, I saw the airport, I was like, oh my God. So we're obviously going somewhere out of England. And then we turned up there and he still didn't tell me where we were going. So
I started walking around the airport, started queuing up at different destinations. Just didn't have a clue. She goes, we're going to Spain. Oh, great. Are we going here? Of course, we didn't have no luggage or anything. So she didn't know how long we were going to go for or anything.
And then we turned up at one of the destinations. It had Italy, Pisa, flashing up on the signs. I was like, oh my God, we're going to Italy for the day.
When we got to the, because I pre-booked the tickets and everything. So when we were trying to go up the top, I couldn't propose to get on my knee because I had all the stuff in my hands. And like we were just,
in the end, I put my jackets on. And
we had a little walk around, and then you see all these like Koreans and Japanese people with their cameras and stuff, and they could almost sense what we were going to do, because like they all like come across and they were like lining up behind us almost, because I was almost like getting this box out, and they can actually always work it out what was going on. And as I was, like, got down to one knee and pulled this box out and opened it and showed her, her jaw just completely
dropped.
She was like it's freeze, and her jaw just dropped. And then I was taking pictures in the background and all through the day, like from when we left on the plane to when we got there, I was telling her how much I love her and how much I'm looking forward to.
I just didn't think anything of it, you know.
She had absolutely.
Didn't even have a clue, just,
no idea.
Well, that's normal.
And when I said, you know, will you marry me, she's good. It's just, her face is just a picture. And I just got on one knee and
I
proposed. As God's mate, she said, yes, of course, you will.
We're all coming up to Surrey, so it's not Hoddesdon, normally typical wedding, you know, you're around the corner, everything should run smoothly. I was the best man at Sal and Sil's wedding, and my role obviously was to make sure that he got to the church on time, made sure that he was, you know, groomed, all, you know, tidied up and ready to go, really. And it was kind of touch and go when we got to the church. It's kind of touch and go, and it was kind of rush, 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 and I dropped him off and parked the car and got in, and it was kind of, God, this, things are moving so quickly.
Good luck. Go away for a month, maybe another month.
If you're ever gonna hold me, it had better be tonight. Or somebody else may hold me, and they might make me feel just right.
And have fun anyway. Have a nice holiday. Enjoy yourselves.
We planned our wedding for 18 months. Every day, every night, every minute was 18 months to plan this wedding. And it was a long 18 months of our lives, I think.
When Silv got to the church, you know, you could feel the tension in the air, but I think once we'd started to eat and got to the hall and everyone was more relaxed, I just sort of went for it, really.
We decided to have an Italian cake because all our guests were Italian, and we thought, well, the best thing is to give them Italian cake, because obviously you're only going to get a little bit for myself. There's no point, me saying, oh, I want this, or I want chocolate cake, or this or that. And I think, well, I've got to really think of what the guests would want to eat. And so we thought the Italian cake was the best. I chose a style of how I wanted it to be, and I gave it to my caterer, and he made it exactly how it was. And I said, just make Italian cake inside.
We chose the caterers because lots of my family have used this caterer and they were trustworthy, and they've been in the business for a long time, and we've been to loads of different weddings.
And we know they're good.
So we know what sort of food they do and price range and value for money. And not only that, they do all the decorations and setting up the room and also liaising with the band, and they knew how the whole day went and how the preparations and stuff.
Seeing them doing saying their vows, saying that having that kiss, you know, they're actually married. Sometimes I think, oh God, you know, is my older brother actually married? You know, actually in a little bit of shock, but a nice shock, sort of thing, happiness for him really, and hopefully one day I might get the same, you know, who's next, type of thing. But it was really just thinking, you know, let's get to the hall and let's really have a really good party and really enjoy the day.
You could see everybody's faces, everyone was smiling and dancing and enjoying themselves. And sometimes I think, is that really me? Is that really me getting married, you know? When we were dancing and they picked us up, and well, first they covered us with confetti and stuff and tied us up with string and the spraying silly string and stuff. But when I took it, we go back to the hotel and I took your dress off, and
it was confetti
everywhere. And you can see how tight you had it, because you had loads of marks because you had a corset.
No, that's because I was holding the dress up, it was so big and heavy.
Yeah, plus it's heavy. Silv got her way with the pink colour scheme, but I got my way with the table plans and organising everybody and naming each table by the Italian football squad that won the World Cup in Germany in 2006. And for example, number one was Buffon, and going through all the different tables all the way to 23, and then having the head table with the manager, Marcello Lippi.
How are you doing?
Okay.
In a bed?
Yeah.
Okay, thank you. How are you doing? All right, yeah? Hello, everybody.
How are you?
Yeah, got him on. Just about. Santa drives like a slug, but we got here.
Slow driver.
Hello.
Hello.
Hello. Hello.
Hello.
Hello.
Hello.
Hello. Hello.
Hello. Hello.
Hello. Hello. Hello. Hello.
Hello. Hello. Hello. Hello. Hello. Hello. Hello. Hello. Hello. Hello.
It wasn't until I got to the church and I was walking down the aisle and I was standing at the altar, I was like shaking, I was like, oh my God, and I was sweating, I was hyperventilating, I was like, oh my God, that was when I was really nervous. But before that, I was calm.
I was a little bit stressed when I was in the hotel room trying to organise everybody, because my parents had to come up the night before and trying to get them all set up, and then the best man and trying to get the video man and the photographer to be in the hotel as well, and then the buttonholes. We couldn't find the buttonholes, so I was a little bit stressing out. But once I had everything organised, I was fine, and because I did most of the organising with the order of service and stuff, so I already knew how the church setup was. So I knew what to say when, you know, saying the vows and things, so I was quite relaxed. And then I was just waiting for Sylvia at the church, and the only thing I was stressed out after that was trying to get there on time, because I got there, supposed to be there at 12 o'clock, and I got there at 12:15. But then Sil was even later, she got there at 12:45, so...
I'll tell you a little funny story. I mean, we nearly had the bride arriving before the groom at the church, because Sal was still doing his makeup, you see, for the day. We were still trying to get it all, you know, he was running a little bit late, but... he made it in the end. I had the priest on me telling me, I've got another wedding to do, can you please hurry up? But I had no bride or groom there.
What about the guy when he got the wedding ring and he thought there was a lid on the bottom?
the priest.
Because what happened is that we'd given him the
crying.
Ring and the bottom lid looked like there was a lid. The lid had been put on the bottom. So the priest, after they'd obviously taken the rings and someone put the rings on, was trying to pull this lid off.
While he was talking.
Yeah, while he was talking.
He was trying to put the
but
lid
he then realised that I still had the ring in my pocket, right, so it was quite funny.
Right,
so
we was quite
it was quite funny.
Our wedding day was the best day of our lives, and we've had so many wonderful times together as well, but the wedding day so far has topped all of them. And I don't think we'll ever get another day as much as beautiful as this one.
Do a toast to Silv and Sal. Happy couple. I hope the future holds loads of babies. You know, obviously for me, it'd be an honour because it'd become an uncle. That'd be absolutely fantastic. I don't know, you know, because Silva, she's in the hairdressing, so salon sort of thing. So Sal works up here at the moment, but I know deep down, I think one thing he does miss is his friends and his family, his side, or, you know, away from everyone. And I know deep down he would probably love to move down, if not Hoddesdon, but at least halfway, a little bit closer. So it's just a 10-15 minute journey to think, I'll go and pop to my mum's or let's go and do this. Because I think he finds it a little bit difficult in the evening to come down and misses that brothers or his friends or even the fact his best man around. So that's one thing that I think he would hope to have.
Yeah, we would definitely be happy ever after. I think we're the perfect couple. We never argue, we've never had an argument before we planned a wedding, obviously. Never argue, even now we never argue. No. We're
so alike, we do things very similar.
We think alike, we do things alike, we are alike.
I think when two people meet and they get together, you always kind of, not question it, but you sort of think, well, you know, it's early days, but now, you know, I look at where they were when they started, when they were together, when they first met, and when it was like, you know, oh, I'm seeing, you know, when he initially met her. But now, looking sort of 5 years down the line, and you look how much they've grown together. Now, yes, I'd say that they'll live happily ever after. I think they don't think they're going to have kids straight away. I think they'll probably give it a couple of years or so, because Salv likes travelling, Silv likes travelling, so I think they want to sort of spend a bit of time maybe travelling around the world, visiting different locations, different countries, because Salv is very sort of, he's got fidgety feet. He likes visiting new places, doesn't he? He's quite a traveller, Salv.
He's always the organiser,
and he always likes, oh God, I've ticked that, I've been there sort of thing. And I think maybe sort of 2-3 years down the line, I think they'll start thinking about, you know, starting a family. But as for me, I think they just want to enjoy the whole couple thing.
No, we're a perfect couple, and we will be happy forever.
Matchmaking in heaven, I think.
Yeah.